guys, welcome back to my channel. If you're new here, hi, welcome. My name is Celeste. I like to talk about true crime stories, and today I actually have a case that's like really stuck with me for quite a while. It's just so crazy. So we're just gonna jump right into it. It's the case of Terri Jendusa Nicolai. Terri met a man named David Larson. They ended up getting married and they had two little girls together. Well, not long after they got married, Terri actually saw David's true nature. He ended up yelling at her for like just crazy things. He yelled at her if the window curtains were out of place, if the towels weren't folded correctly. He insisted that she kept like the door open when she was showering or using the bathroom. And she was just so afraid of his explosive temper. If she did one little thing wrong, she was so scared of how he would react. For example, she accidentally broke glass one time, so she had to pick the glass up and put it in the trash of her neighbor so that he wouldn't see it. On one occasion, David came home and he found a frozen sausage link in the trash can. So he pulled it out of the trash and he's like, "Why is this in the trash?" And it had like freezer burn on it. And he just got so mad. He's like, "You're wasting my money." So she's like, "If you want it so bad, I can cook it up for you." There was another fight, which was really stupid, over spaghetti. She was getting ready to cook dinner one night and she had all of the ingredients and everything she needed on the counter. And this included a little thing of like pasta that was dry. She hadn't used it yet. David came in and he demanded that she put everything away before it went bad. And Terri was like, "Don't you want me to make dinner?" It didn't matter if David like had some crazy like wants or needs, whatever he said she had to do. Well, it ended up escalating into this huge thing where Terri ended up running down to the basement. She didn't know where else to go. And on the door of the basement, David installed locks. Well, he actually installed locks on all the doors where only his key could open it. While she's down there, her first thought is, "I'm 30 years old and I'm hiding from my husband in my basement. What am I doing?" That's so sad. So Terri knew that one day, unfortunately, when the girls were older, David was gonna end up abusing them as well. So out of fear, Terri ended up taking her children and going to a shelter, and she was fearing for her life at this point. So this was a good thing because after this, they finally got a divorce, but in the courtroom, David ended up threatening Terri after the divorce was finalized, saying, "You're gonna regret this one day." Well, fast forward 3 years later, Terri ended up marrying a man named Nick Nicolai. And they wanted to start a family together. They obviously had the two little girls, but they also wanted a child of their own. Well, they found out one morning that Terri was gonna be having another baby, and she hadn't told anybody yet. She was keeping it to herself. Well, she was also fighting for custody of the girls with David. They had to go back and forth to each parent. In the court system, she was really trying to get full custody, but the court was like, "Well, you have a dad here that wants to see the girls, who wants to be in their lives, so you need to share custody with them." And she was like, "He beats me." And they were like, "Well, there's no evidence of this, unfortunately," which it literally did not help anything. He still had custody of the girls and Terri was in danger. Whenever Terri would have like her husband, Nick, come with her to get the girls, David would get so mad. He's like, "I don't bring my girlfriend to pick up the girls from your house. How dare you?" So she wasn't really allowed to have other people accompany her when she was coming to get the girls from his house or even dropping off, because he didn't like it and she just didn't want the confrontation, so she would just do it herself all the time. So I forgot to mention, this is all going on in Wisconsin. So as Terri had to take the girls to and from David's house, she ended up having to call the cops multiple times on him because things would just get out of hand. And during this time, she had to go to like public places to drop the girls off and pick them up just because she did not feel comfortable going to the house. And the house that David was staying at was the house that him and Terri used to live in when they were married. She eventually got a restraining order on him, but this didn't do much for the whole situation. David would even show the girls, they were young, they were really young, they were under the age of 7. He would keep all the mementos from him and Terry's life up from this point. So he had pictures of their wedding, videos from their wedding, of just their life leading up to the divorce. And he would sit the girls down and show them everything and say, "Look, we got married, but your mommy didn't keep the promise." So one morning, On January 31st, 2004, Terri was actually going to go pick up the girls from David's house. It was 17 degrees outside and snowing. And before she left, she actually was planning on telling the girls that day that she was going to be having another baby. So her plan was to just pick the girls up and go. She asked David to have them ready when she got there so they could just get in the car and go. And of course, her husband Nick did not go with her because she didn't want confrontation. So Nick stayed home. When she got to David's house, David did not have the girls ready, and so she was kind of frustrated. She waited in her car for a minute and still nothing. David ended up coming outside and saying, he was very calm, which is very unusual. He told Terri that the girls were playing hide and seek and they wanted her to find them. Well, Terri was very uncomfortable with the situation, and not only that, David had not let her in the house since they've been divorced. And this is 3 years on the day of them being divorced. So exactly 3 years ago, the divorce was finalized. David have never let her in that house since then. Well, he was like, come on, the girls are playing hide and seek, just go find them. Well, she didn't want to let the girls down, so she finally walked inside, and it was a terrible idea. She should have listened to her gut. Well, 3 hours from when Terri was supposed to pick up the girls and be straight home, Nick has not heard from her. He ended up calling the police and letting them know everything. And they already had record of David and this address because the cops have been called multiple times to this place due to Terri being uncomfortable or just crazy things happening and that restraining order. So the cops ended up going down there and there was nobody home, there was no car or anything. Obviously, they didn't see Terri or the girls or even David. They ended up going and asking neighbors if they saw anything at all, and some of the neighbors said that they saw David towing Terri's car off earlier that morning. So what ended up happening when Terri walked in the house to go find the girls while we were playing hide and seek, she walked inside and David closed the door and ended up hitting her over the head and she went unconscious. She's laying on the floor in the kitchen, and when she finally comes to, she notices David is standing over her with a bat in his hand, and he just starts beating her with this bat. And as he's beating her, she's like trying so hard to like reconcile, like tell him, it's okay, I won't go to court anymore. Like, I don't need full custody. We will figure this out. I'm sorry. Like, she was begging for her life. David did not care. He kept beating her and beating her. She went unconscious again. He ended up taking duct tape and wrapping it around her wrists and her ankles. He ripped her pants off and then put a towel in her mouth so that she would suffocate, and then duct taped her head to her neck, like just completely full of duct tape. He grabbed an empty trash bin, put her body inside of it, went outside and started shoveling snow from his lawn into this trash bin. And again, it was 17 degrees outside. All while this is happening, the girls were still in the house. They were locked in the room by David. He put a movie on for them and it was up really loud. It was past lunchtime, so they were hungry and they were crying. They did not know anything about what was going on. He grabbed them, he put them in the car, and he ended up driving off. He was on his way to a nearby storage unit, which was actually in another state, that he rented this storage unit to put the trash bin in there. So he had planned this for quite a while. The cops finally came back to David's house, and when they entered his house, they saw a pool of blood in the kitchen and women's black pants near the trash can. From now on, there was this huge investigation looking for Terri and the girls. They found out eventually that David had work. He was working at an air traffic control center and he had not been at work yet. The minute David got into work, the cops were already there waiting for him. And they asked him, do you know that your ex-wife is missing? And he's like, no, she never showed up to my house to pick up the girls this morning. So I dropped the girls off at my girlfriend's house and came straight to work. Well, they ended up taking him down to the station and they questioned him. It was like 4 a.m. at this point. The police were questioning him and they knew that what he was saying was a lie. So they ended up telling him, we found her pants at your house with a pool of blood. And at this point, David is like, oh crap. He knows that they know something is up and he just starts freaking out and he gets really emotional. His explanation is that when Terri came to pick up the girls, she attacked him and that it was just self-defense, and then whatever happened after that, he doesn't remember because it was a blur. So they ended up confiscating most of David's personal items, and one of these items was his wallet. Inside of his wallet, they found a business card for like a storage unit center that was in the other state, which is the one where he put her body, and it had a phone number on it. The police ended up calling the storage unit to talk to whoever was there, like the person in charge, and it was confirmed that David had been there that morning. Well, they knew this was really suspicious, so they asked the employee, like, hey, can you go check this storage unit? Here's the number, and let me know if you hear anything inside, because there's an active investigation going on of a missing woman. We need to know if she's there. So this employee goes over to this storage unit, and as he's there, he hears moaning coming from inside. He goes back, calls the cops, lets them know. Well, the cops end up rushing down there. They have the local police that are in the area go down there as well. They open up the storage unit, and inside there's just stuff everywhere, and they don't notice a person. Well, it's very quiet, and they don't hear moaning or anything. They notice a black trash in the corner with duct tape on it, so they assume, okay, there has to be something in there. There's duct tape, because there's nowhere else in this storage unit that a body could be hiding. As soon as they open it, Terri is inside, and the body is so unrecognizable. Terri was also alive in the storage unit. She was still alive. They ended up calling an ambulance, and she was taken right away. Inside of the storage unit, it was 20 degrees, and her body temperature was 86 degrees. She was going in and out of consciousness. She was blacking out constantly. At this point, it's been 26 hours since she's gone missing. The doctors say that she actually was an hour away from dying due to all of the conditions. And it's crazy she's even alive now. So what actually happened was the only reason Terri stayed alive was because she kept telling herself she needs to be there for her daughters. And she pretended to be dead the entire time. So once David duct taped her and put her in the trash can and put her in the back of the truck, he was so worried about just getting away with murdering her that he didn't really check for a cell phone or anything else. Terri had a jacket on. She didn't have pants on, but she did have a jacket. And in her jacket pocket was her cell phone. So as David got the girls in the car and they started driving away, Terri called the cops and she told them that she was attacked by her ex-husband, David. She gave the address of the house and she didn't know that she was moving. She didn't know they were driving because she's in this trash can. She's all wrapped up and everything. She hangs up the 911 call. As they're driving, she hears cops pass the car and they have no idea Terry's in the back of the truck. So they go, that's the reason why they went back to the house and went inside and found the blood, because Terri called them. Well, at this point, Terry's like, they have no idea I'm here. What, like, I have to call them again. She ends up calling 911 again. The dispatcher she gets isn't the same people she had just called, because since they're moving, it's gonna go to a different police station in another like county because they're driving. So she calls, and this other dispatcher that answers is so rude, like does not believe her. They think it's a prank call. So she has all this duct tape over her. She's having trouble breathing. She's freezing. And she's trying to let the dispatcher know what's going on. And the dispatcher's like, what's your name? And she's trying to say her name, but it's not coming out fully. She began explaining to the dispatcher that she had duct tape all over her mouth and her hands were duct taped together. And the dispatcher was like, why can't you just stand up? And she's like, I can't. And she's like, if your wrists are duct taped together, then how are you even holding your phone? By this point, Terri is just so out of it. She can barely talk anymore. So all she's doing is just heavy breathing, just trying to stay alive. And she's trying so hard not to black out again. And the dispatcher literally tells her, ma'am, are you gonna speak to me or are you just gonna sit on the phone and breathe heavily? And she hangs up on her. She now is not talking to the police because they just hung up on her because they thought it was a prank call. It's honestly a miracle that she lived. She ended up playing dead after David was beating her because she knew if she didn't play dead, he would continue to beat her. And the doctors even said that if he would have beat her one more time with the bat, she would have been dead due to all of the injuries on her brain already. She ended up losing the baby that she was carrying, but she made it out alive. And her reasoning was, as long as you have family and children to look forward to, that's all that mattered in that point of time for her. That's what got her through the whole situation. So David is now serving a life sentence in prison and actually owes Terri over $3 million, but she knows she's not gonna get that money. What Terri does now is she goes to college campuses and to women's group and speaks out about domestic violence. So she turned her tragedy into something that she can help other people with. Honestly, this case was one of those cases that I feel like is never gonna, like, leave my memory. It's just so sad, and I'm just so happy she was okay, and now she can live her life without David being anywhere near her, and she has her kids. If you like listening to videos like this, or even true crime in general, go ahead and click that like button, and click subscribe, and click on the bell. That way you get notified whenever I post a new video. But until then, thanks guys for watching. Bye.